Alrighty, ready. Here we go. Testing, testing. Let me know if you guys hear me loud and clear. This is, of course, your host, ID Jester. Thank you so much for checking out our video tonight. This is a live stream, of course, for Tigers on the Hunt. So, of course, Tigers on the Hunt is a World War II tactical infantry combat system that has strongly been inspired by the old ASL board game. So, if you're familiar with that game, you'll be able to pick up Tigers on the Hunt and be able to play it right off the bat. I just want to give a big shout out to Matrix Games, Slytherin, and of course the developer for giving me a pre-released version here so I can share some of my videos and some of my time with you guys and show you some gameplay here. So thanks a lot to all of those fine folks for getting me a nice pre-released version of the game so that I can spend some time showing you how to play this wonderful game. So thank you very much. A few things before we actually start. If you are watching this afterwards on my YouTube channel, of course you can subscribe to our regular Twitch channel at www.twitch.tv/IDJester. Of course, if you become a subscriber and wish, you can ask for an email anytime we go live. You'll get an email letting you know that what we're going live with and what game we're playing and everything. So to become a subscriber if you're watching this afterwards, or if you're in the live stream today and like what you see, go ahead and become a subscriber as well. So that's the first note of business. Second note of business is Tigers on the Hunt is being developed by Silicon Soft Systems and of course being published by Matrix Games and Slytherin. So if you want to find out more information about Tigers on the Hunt, please do visit those fine folks' webpage. And of course, if you enjoy what you see here tonight, I would highly recommend that you pick up the game and invest a few dollars in many, many, many hundreds of hours of time that you can spend playing this game. So third and lastly on our to-do list here is to let everyone know that we will be live streaming every single night up until the release of Tigers on the Hunt, which is February 25th. So just a few short weeks. No, not even a few short weeks. It's only a week from, let's see, week from yesterday, I believe, is when it's going to be coming out. So yes, very short amount of time before the actual full release of this game. Again, if you want to find out more information about this, go to the Slytherin webpage or, of course, the Matrix Games webpage as well. I will be hosting a special event on Monday, February 22nd at 2 o'clock. p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Eastern Standard Time, so of course you might have to adjust your time zone to figure out when it's going to be. We're going to be doing another live stream of Tigers on the Hunt where we are going to continue playing our scenario, or creating our scenario that we did last week. And we're going to finish that scenario up. And it's been a lot of fun working with everyone trying to create us a really cool scenario that we're going to be able to have and publish for you guys once the full release of the game. So I think I got all the business out of the way. Now let's go ahead and get started here. Of course, we are looking at Tigers of the Hunt. So we're actually going to go in and play us a game. Oh, you know what? First things first, there was one more piece of business I have to take care of before that. I just want the developer and the publishers to know I really, really, really like the artwork that came with this game here, the Tigers on the Hunt. This beautiful depiction here. I've been meaning to tell you guys that, and very, very cool. It just gives you that orange feel of a battlefield that you're about to partake in. So anyways, I just wanted to let everyone know, good job on that. I'm not sure who actually did the painting there, but it's absolutely amazing and I love it. So obviously, as you can see, it's my desktop. All right, anyways, let's go ahead and get started here. Obviously, we are playing Tigers on the Hunt. Again, this game is being developed by SiliconSoft Systems, which I believe is like one person. So big kudos to go out to the developer to take it upon himself that he is interested in creating a computer game that, again, is strongly influenced by the old ASL rules, and hopefully his inspiration and his desires to bring this game to the masses will obviously scratch an itch. Many of us have been dying to get itched. So anyways, you can see there's quite a list of scenarios that come with the game already edited into the game, a couple training scenarios. And you can see down here at the bottom, we actually have quite a few scenarios that we've already created ourselves. It looks like, now again, I should mention this is a pre-released version of the game, so I'm not sure if there will be any scenarios added previous to full release, but at this time, there's a 25 scenarios plus, of course, 4 training scenarios. I myself have only had the game for a very short amount of time, not very long whatsoever, and I've already been able to create a few scenarios here. A 13 dozen assault over the bridge. This is our live stream one we were doing the other day. We actually have an Omaha Beach one, and of course, The Longest Night and Revenge for Bruno. So tonight, we're going to be playing one of the scenarios that I created. It's called Revenge for Bruno. So the information is 10th of July, 1943, near the village of Tupolev, Russia. During the Battle of Kursk, the German troops lost one of their most beloved tank commanders by the name of Bruno. This loss sent shockwaves across the whole 4th Panzer Division, and many Germans were out for revenge. On the morning of July 10th, the attack near the village of Tepoli saw such an engagement. The German vehicles were painted red on the side with just a single name, Bruno. Revenge for their fallen hero would come at a steep price at the hands of a well-placed Russians. And of course, you can see here we have units here, German squads, light machine guns, heavy machine guns, and AFVs. Russians, you're going to be up against squads, light machine guns, heavy machine guns, light mortars, and ordnance. And I do have to edit this information because I've actually added for the German side OOB, off-board artillery. So so I should edit this file so that's been updated. Of course, it's two maps. The terrain is going to be rural with hills and water. It's going to be 9 game turns in length. Scenario objective is the side with the most victory points at the end is the winner. Both sides will get victory points for owning victory point objectives. And of course, the scenario designer is moi. Ha ha ha. So, Revenge for Bruno. And we're going to go ahead and start up a new game here. We are going to be playing as the advancing attacking player as the Germans. Our opponent, let's try it that way, is going to be the computer player. They're in hold, and of course, the Russian. Difficulty here, we're going to set it on... What do I want to set it on? So the difficulty modes basically represent a command and control feature that's been programmed into the game. And whether or not your actual units are in commands and they know what to do. So I've been doing normal mode, and I think I will continue normal mode so people can ease into it a little bit easier. And then as closer to release day, we'll actually try a hard or very hard scenario. I should mention that the developer has mentioned that the difficulty should default to hard to make it a little bit harder for the human player and a little bit easier for the computer. So might be a little bit too easy for us. I don't know. I made this scenario up, so it could be we are, you know, to have too many units. This is kind of a balancing thing that we need to figure out, and that's why I just want to play it on normal, just so I can compare and see, Do the Germans have too many units? Do the Russians have too many units, etc.? Fog of War, we are going to enable Fog of War. Of course, you can, of course, disable Fog of War. So you have those two options there. We are going to enable it. And then, of course, last but not least, we have Path Quality. This basically determines how much computer strength goes into the actual AI pathing and being able to figure out the best calculations for the enemy. So we're going to give them the best chance possible. We're going to go ahead and say high quality there. So that's going to be our setup. And of course, we're going to go right into turn number one after we have the pregame setup sequence. So right now, you're seeing this kind of orangish looking map. But trust me, that's not what it looks like. We have to scroll down to our actual map that we are going to be playing on. This basically is out of bounds for everyone. So that's not playable terrain. And it's just an overlay that you can do when you're creating your scenarios. Quick and easy to set up where units are allowed to go. So if you're joining us a little late, welcome, welcome. We are playing Tigers on the Hunt. This game is full released on February 25th. Be sure to check out the Slytherin website or Matrix Games to get all of the information about this if you're enjoying what you like. So here's our units, basically up here in the top left-hand corner. And we have obviously have something to do here because I see lots of Russian symbols on the board. So first thing you want to probably do is come up here and check out your victory conditions here. Well, we'll look at the scenario attributes first. So basically it tells you the name, how long the scenario is. In this case, it's 9 turns. We're going to have only a day visibility of 9 hexes. So it's morning fog. If you missed our intro in the beginning there, there's kind of a little bit of mist going on in the morning here. So only 9 hexes. AI difficulty, we're going to set it normal. AI attitude is going to be advanced. Pathfinding, of course, is hard. Computer, blah, blah, blah. Here's our scenario date. Real good, easy way to really check out how the battle's set up, if you forget. And then, of course, we're going to go up to status, and then we're going to go to scenario objectives here. So you can see there are 6 objectives. Every single one of them is worth 5 points. So they're all equal in points. And you can see as side B, which is the Germans, we need to capture at least 25 or more of these points for a major victory, 20 or more for a minor, 15 or more for a draw, 10 for a minor defeat, and 5 or less for a major defeat. So let's hope that doesn't happen. Over here you can see we actually do not have any points set up for removal of enemy units. So in this case it doesn't matter if we get all of our units killed as long as we have the objectives at the end of the scenario. So right now you can see the Germans are obviously have a major defeat. Looks like we have a location right here, 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 and here, and here. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So for a major victory, we need to get 5 of those 6. That's what we need to be able to get a major victory. And then, so we got 3 of them up here. We have 3 of them down here. So obviously we got a bunch of infantry units here. Looks like we got some AFVs over here, some other units as well. And if you want to check out what units you have, you're actually going to come up here to this button right here, Order of Battle, which tells us exactly everything we have. So you can see we got some elite squads, some light machine guns, demo charges, some more elite squads, light machine guns, more demo charges. We do have a squad with a heavy machine gun and a mortar. We have some Faschenjägers, elite squads. We've got some sergeants here, and then we have a really good sergeant, a Sergeant B, and he has a radio. And we have, looks like, some more line squads, and then of course there are, looks like we have 2 Panzer IV F1s and a couple Studekampfs, 251-9 and a 251 SMG. Don't ask me about the difference because I couldn't tell you the difference between them. I'm not that in the know here about what the difference between them are, other than they're not the same. So there we go. All right, you can see we cannot go up to the north, so we're not going to be able to swing around to the north. It looks like we're going to have to bust in this way, come across, and come this way. We only have 9 hexes of terrain to go through. Looks like we have nice cover here along the river or pond or lake or whatever this is. So what I think I'm going to do is try to bring some of my units into the forest and kind of cross to see what we got over there. Some of our other forces are going to come out kind of at the edge of the forest and see what's in this first part of the town. Our vehicles will start pushing up kind of in the middle here. And of course, once we do find something, I think what we'll do is activate our off-board artillery and see if we can blast them. I have a feeling, now I've created this scenario, so you guys don't have any idea, but I do. I know where things are. But you can kind of just, you know, if you were the defender, where would you set up? Obviously, you'd have some units set up across the bridge over here, and then you'd have some other units protecting your southern flank. And, of course, we have a nice hill up here, which is going to be able to shoot over anything there, because it's a level 1 hill. That's what this texture is. And, of course, they got some trees to hide in. So, obviously, probably going to be something there. So, you know what? In the pregame setup segment, we're not going to be setting up anything. This scenario is set up so everybody has their units already on the board. And thanks for joining us. If you're joining us late, we will be doing a live stream pretty much every day until the full release of Tigers on the Hunt, which will be February 25th. So 6 short days from now. So pregame setup segment pretty much over. We're not going to have to worry about setting units up. Now we go on to the administrative segment. So in this segment, basically what you're going to be doing is you're going to be rolling to see whether or not you're in command. And also you're going to try to rally your units that are broken. You're going to try and fix your broken weapons. And of course, you're going to... what else are you going to do? You're going to try and pick up weapons off the ground as well. So because this is a beginning scenario, we don't have anything like that to do, so we're going to go ahead and skip on to the next segment, which of course is the fire segment. You can see in a result window down here at the bottom, everybody's in command, and that is because we have set it up on normal difficulty, which will be everybody's going to be in command for us, and everybody will be in command for the enemies. So this is a couple of maps that I had actually... I believe I made this map, and this one might have been a default map, but I've changed it a little bit in the to make it what I want for our scenario. So if you missed out on our video on the editor, we're doing another live stream on that Monday, February 22nd at 2 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So we're going to continue that. And of course, part one video is of course on the Matrix Games website. So go to their webpage and they will have a link to that location. So, fire segment. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to go off on a... where is our leader here? There he is. There's our B leader. So, each leader is represented with A, B, C, and D. A being the best leader and D being the worst leader. And then they have a number of stars on their actual counters here. If I right-click the hex, you can see that. So if it doesn't have any stars, it just gives a normal bonus. And for each extra star, you get a better bonus. So this B leader is giving a slightly better bonus than one without a star. So it's quick and easy to decide. You can see who your better leaders are. And of course, this is a B leader. If we compare that with, say, this guy over here, you can see he's a C leader, so he is not giving as many characteristics out, but he is giving a nice bonus as well. I think most of the German leaders are giving some nice bonuses, so that is going to obviously help keep our units in good fighting fashion. All right, so for those of you who have not seen any off-board artillery, OBA, we've actually got some set up for the German players, so we're going to actually try that. We're going to look at our radio here, and I'm just thinking I'm going to target somewhere down here because there's going to be some units. You know, they're not going to just let us walk down here and into the the other end of town. You know that. And especially since there's a victory point location. So I'm just going to target somewhere in here and hope we just cream something in that location. So all I'm going to do is select the radio here. And I am going to... What am I going to do here? Where can we find? I'm just trying to find a location that... I don't think we can actually see that spot, so I'm not sure. Well, we'll get back to him. Let's go ahead and Let's see. We have. What do we have here? Some demo. We do have a heavy machine gun. Again, we don't really have anybody to see. All right. So we're actually just going to bypass the fire segment here to begin with. We really want to find some units anyways. So now we're going to go in the movement segment. So we are going to click on our units. And you can individually click on them and move them. Or you can hold the control key down and you can select more than one unit. Or select the whole stack, whatever you want to do. If your units move with the leader, you will get a bonus to the amount of movement points you have, which you can see is going to be good for us because we have a nice leader. So hopefully you can move these guys up. The little white dots on here are the fire range of the units that we have selected here. So you can see we can turn that on and off. And I highly recommend you click on the little line of sight tool button here and make sure you leave that on all the time. That will show you whenever an enemy comes into line of sight, or when you go to shoot, it'll show you all your enemies that are in line of sight. So you don't have to try and figure out which units are in line of sight. So for these guys, we're going to move everybody up. Of course, we don't need to select the light machine gun. It's automatically going to move with the squad. And you have three different modes. You have normal mode of movement. You have assault. Assault basically lets you move into just one adjacent space. If any defensive fire happens, of course, you get a bonus against that fire. Double time gives you more movement points, but of course, it tires your unit out, so you cannot double time the following turn. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to double time because I'm going to try and get quite a few units in the middle of this forest here in case there's anybody in there. I want to be prepared. So I want to select our sergeant. Make sure he's going with everyone, because again, if you're with a leader, you will get a bonus. Yep, we're going to have radio contact for OBA. I'm going to show you that here probably next turn, or maybe when it's our bottom half, when we're the defenders, we can set that up. And we're going to show you how the radio contact for the OBA happens. Okay, Jack? And welcome, Jack. Jack is one of my longtime subscribers on my YouTube channel. Love Jack. He's a great guy, and he's stuck with me all these years. I don't know why he does it, but he's always has some good comments and suggestions and everything. Big ASL guy back in the day, so welcome, Jack. Anyone else out there that wants to chat or has questions, be sure to just type them in the chat line there. All right, so we've got our double time in here. Again, we get a couple extra movement points because we're double timing. And we get a couple extra movement points because we got a leader. All we have to do is select our units and then, of course, right-click to move into that hex. And you can see the units here are tired, 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 and running, 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 and they're moving, moving, moving. And we're just going to continue moving up. And obviously, more movement points are spent to go into any kind of non-clear hex, so when you move into forest or brush or buildings, or if you're moving uphill, all kinds of extra movement points there. That's why we're actually double timing. I want to get as far in here and have several rounds of attack on these guys. Obviously, if I move into this hex right here, if there's anybody over here, they would see us and be able to defensive fire. So I'm going to try and stay away from the edge right now. So far, and now you notice that all my hexes around me are red. The red symbol means if I move into that hex, that will be the very last hex that I can move into for this turn. So my decisions are to come over here, and again, if there's units over here, they will be able to defensive fire, because then I will be seen by the enemy. Right now, these woods are blocking their line of sight. You cannot see through woods to the hex beyond it. So I don't want defensive fire. So we're actually going to move these guys right into the brush. Now you might think, well, that's kind of, you know, why are you doing that? Don't you want to be adjacent there? Well, there's advantages and disadvantages, which we're going to talk about. Jack is all blushing in there because he doesn't like me calling him out like that. Anyways, he's been one of my longtime subscribers, so we're just going to select the next stack here, which looks like just a sergeant, some Faschenjagers there, and a light machine gun. Basically, same thing. Notice I didn't have to adjust whatever I move. It just keeps that button down, which is really good because it prevents you from clicking on it over and over and over again. The problem is, if you change modes and forget that you changed it, you have to change it back. So, for example, if I wanted these guys to move, and then the next group I wanted to double time, I would have to remember to click on the double time. So, always check your little movement calculator over here before you move. All right, here we go. So, Faschenjagers and our sergeant. Again, we're going to get some bonus movement points. We are going to double time. We're going to try and move these guys up. Obviously, moving through the grain, moving. We're going to move into this hex, and that will be it. Alright, next group. What do we have in here? Looks like we got some leads, some demo charges. We do have a heavy machine gun, and we have a sergeant here. Okay, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to actually take the sergeant and the heavy machine gun. I'm going to bring them right over here, if I can. And I'm going to position them here to kind of take out any units that are sitting over there. So I'm not going to select everyone because I want these other elites to keep assaulting the town back down here. So we got to figure out where we want to go. We want to end up right here. So we have line of sight across. We could end up right in anywhere in here, but I would like to be a little bit closer over here. So what we're going to do is try to move these guys as far as we can. There we go. That's perfect. That's actually perfect because your heavy machine guns and your medium machine guns cannot fire in the advanced fire phase. So we're going to talk about that when we get to that phase. We got some more elites. We're going to double time these guys. There we go. Looks like we got an AT rifle and a machine gun and a sergeant. So there we go. We're just going to move these guys up. I've got to start being careful here because I think in the beginning they didn't have line of sight because it was only 9 hexes, but now you notice we're only 6 short hexes away. So, have to be careful. Ooh. Oh! Alright, so I mentioned one thing to you guys about how woods blocks line of sight, but woods does not block line of sight if it directly goes down the road line, which it does here in this case, you can see. And unfortunately, our sergeant has become broken. Our elite squad has been casually reduced. So each squad is about, I think it's 10 guys. And so like 5 guys just got mowed down by this attack. And of course, they become broken as well. And it looks like the light machine gun did not keep its rate of fire. So it is a machine gun, and just like the old ASL board game rules, if you know anything about that system, machine guns, light machine guns, medium machine guns, heavy machine guns have a rate of fire, so you can possibly, depending on how they do, attack with them more than once. If we look at our actual stack of units here, you will notice we have a broken unit, which is our leader. We have our broken leader here. And we have our 2 elite units here, which are fine. So let's... Wow. That was not a good showing there. Our leaders should have helped protected our guys, told them to get their butts down. All right, let's see. Can we... We can't move these guys. Okay, so they're out of movement points. Well, we now know where they're at, so that's a good thing. So what we're going to try to do is we're going to use our lieutenant and some of our first line units here, and we're going to try and put them into this house right here so they have a nice, they can call in some off-board artillery here in just a minute. Put them there, put them there, put them there, and put them inside the building. There we go. Ah, now we got line of sight. We have, let's see what we're up against here so far. It looks like we've got us a couple first line units with a machine gun. And what do we have in here? Oh yeah, look at that. Three first line units, a leader, and a couple of machine guns as well. So this is obviously, they're not willing to give up this location quite so easily. Alright, so at least we now know something we're up against. So what we have to do is get the rest of our units into some good firing positions, hopefully. We're going to bring these guys up and try to put these guys into this building right here. There we go. Do you think we can make it all the way over here? I doubt it. I really, really doubt it. Oh, there's defensive fire. Alright, medium machine gun kept its rate of fire. Whew, okay, so we can always go back and look at our results and what had happened. You just use a little scroll bar here, obviously. And you can see the medium machine gun in fire, and it kept its rate of fire, and that's pretty much it. Now, the reason it didn't shoot again is based upon how many movement points you actually spend to go into the hex. And if you spend more than one movement point, then it would have probably taken another shot at us. Hey, vey. Do I risk moving up again? I don't know. That's going up against a medium machine gun. Now, you notice these units are highlighted now. That means that's the line of sight tool we talked about earlier that is very valuable. Make sure you have that turned on so that way you can see what units. Now we can see if we move into this hex, it'll be our last movement hex. All right, let's do it. Oh, wow. Oh my gosh, we're getting crushed. All right, so our sergeant's been wounded. So when a leader gets hit, they can either take a severe wound and instantly be killed, or they can take a minor wound. In this case, we have a minor wound, but of course, anytime your leader is wounded, their bonuses go down. He broke. Our elite squad has been casually reduced and become broken. They also failed their experience check, which they've been veterans, and now they're going to be replaced by a half squad, which of course is broken, and it kept its rate of fire once again. Okay, well, it's time to bring up some reinforcements here. So, click on our unit. We want to click it down here. Decide which of these units. Again, same thing like we're doing with regular units. If there's more than one unit, you're going to actually hold the control key down. All right, so for vehicles, over here in the corner is what we're going to do with our vehicles. So we're actually going to start up our vehicle here. Facing will show you which way it's going to go. If it has a turreted vehicle, you will see that the arrow is actually a green. If it doesn't have a turret, it'll be in red. And what we're going to do here is Alright, so it's like a rifle shot at us. Ooh. Fortunately, he had to shoot through the grain here, so hopefully that kept him from hitting us. I don't want to shoot through the grain. I want to be on the other side of the grain. Obviously, it'll make the enemy easier to hit us, but it'll also give us an easier chance of hitting them. Alright, so medium machine gun took a pot shot at us and does not keep his rate of fire. So that thing has done some serious damage to us. But fortunately, it's now no longer going to be active. So we were going to go ahead and... Do we take another step forward? I think we do, because we've got some vehicles we want to... We don't want this guy blocking our other vehicles past. So I think we are going to move up one more step. Don't hit us! Don't hit us! Okay. So our Russian leader is, looks like a light machine gun took a shot at us. Okay. So now what we're going to do is actually stop our vehicle. And stopping a vehicle costs movement points as well. So when you do that, they can defensive fire on you. So, but being stopped will allow us to have a little bit better opportunity to do some damage in the next round. Alright, next guy here, same thing, starter up. This guy we're gonna bring down. You see, we basically box yourself in because there's a building and a thing here. So what we have to do is actually rotate our cover arc. We want to rotate it to the right, so I have to always remember. There we go. Now we can move. Now we can rotate it back to the left. Something else here. What do we have up here, shall we say? Heavy machine gun, and it did not keep its rate of fire. Alright, so it looks like first line squad and a weapon up there. Of course, there are going to be some weapons up here on the top of the hill just waiting for us to advance, right? Alright, same thing. This time we're going to start up our. They notice we have more buttons over here. So we have our vehicle arc and we also have our turreted arc. They can of course be in different directions. So to see what they have to against our vehicle. Seven, eight, nine. Okay, so I'm just figuring if there's something else on the hill, if it was something in this hex, it would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we would possibly be in line of sight. So I think we'll stop right there. We can always go back and I want to actually protect our weaker vehicles with our tanks, is what I'm hoping to do. All right, you know, I don't want to get too crazy and get up here. Who knows? I mean, you might have all kinds of things. Good question, Jack. Jack asks, how can I tell which Soviet units are still capable of firing? I'm going to show you that. There is up here in the tool panel under the M, it's markers here. So you can turn markers on and off. If I have them like on, you can see the units that don't have any more movement points whatsoever are kind of grayed out a little bit. And then, of course, you have your first fire counters, your final fire counters, and obviously underneath your leaders, you can kind of see the counters stacked with whatever's there as well. So you can see that this unit here at the top, for the Russians, is able to fire. The unit below it is already fired one defensive time and has a first fire counter. So I normally play with the counters off until the end of you know, kind of the end of the turn, so I can figure out where who I need to keep moving. But I mean, you can just leave these on. I sometimes do that as well. So let's just, I guess we'll leave them on just to show you guys a little bit So we have a light mortar here. All right. Okay. Yep. All right. So we're actually going to move our Faschen Jäger there. Double time it. It's going to need to. Oops. Here we go. Come on. There we go. All right. Move him up here. And there we go. All right. Mortar unit. We're going to move differently. That's all right. All right. And now we have some more elite squads, a sergeant. One of them has a machine gun. Again, I'm going to kind of move them over. Towards this area there. And our last one here. Great question, Jack. Once again, Jack comes through, asks a wonderful, good question there. There we go. And of course, you see the little dots of where the unit moved from. And I think you see some of them are not all grayed out, which means they might have a movement point left, but they don't have enough to actually move into a thicker brush or trees or woods. So I think we now have to resist their attacks, and hopefully we can do that. So let's go ahead and go from the movement segment. I'm pretty sure I've done everything I want to do. Yeah, I would like to move that mortar up here, but I can't. These guys are in a good position right there. Again, we can hit the R. Oops, I have to actually select a unit. I can click the R button. And show you guys its range. Hello. Oh, because I think I've already moved him. We're not in actual shooting time. So let's go ahead and go from movement, obviously, to defensive fire. So, okay. No defensive fire? No? No? Okay. Advancing fire. All right. This is where we get to give them some payback now. So if you're unfamiliar with the old ASL rules, any unit that moves can then fire in the advanced fire segment after, of course, defensive fire happens. In the movement phase, of course, your firing capabilities are extremely limited unless you have some special capabilities. So I'm actually going to show you, let's see if I got a... All right, this is a good example. So you see these elite units here. So they have, again, letter classifications on how much firepower they have, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. So it goes from A to H. You can see these guys are just E units. When we looked at one of these other units here, you notice these are D units with a plus symbol. So the plus symbol represents these units are slightly better in the advanced fire segment. They don't lose half of their firepower. They're slightly better than that. So that's what the plus symbol represents. So these Faschen Jägers, obviously they're good at moving and then firing after they move. Some of the other units, like the elite units we just looked at, they're not as good at moving and firing. They need time to, you know, get into their positions and such. All right, so anyways, anytime we click on a unit now, because I have this wonderful line of sight tool, it's quickly and easily I can determine whether or not they have anybody to shoot at. You can see this guy has nobody to shoot at. This guy's got nobody to shoot at. Obviously, we've got woods that are blocking line of sight, but I'm just showing you when we move up. Obviously, these broken units, if they were not broken, could shoot at this guy. In fact, I think everyone in this hex is broken. No, actually, we have a couple units. We have a couple of elite units, and we have a light machine gun. All right, so we will actually select those units. Thank you. We'll take our light machine gun and our two not broken units, and we'll make an attack against this hex here. Notice the broken units obviously cannot attack. It doesn't matter how much firepower you have. If you're broken, you're broken. So we don't want that. All right. We're going to go ahead and take a shot at him. Hello, shot. Here we go. Am I doing something wrong here? Okay, select them. Thank you. Now, let's shoot with this first, then. That's what we'll do. We'll shoot with this first. All right, so I selected my tank, and then I selected it down here. Then it will pop up this little miniature window, and ask you, do you want to attack with your main armament, your bow, your coaxial, and of course your AAMG if it has one. The only time you can fire with your AAMG, which is of course is your anti-aircraft machine gun, which is mounted at the top of your vehicle, is for you to be unbuttoned. So we are not unbuttoned, so that is obviously not available for us. But we will choose our main armament. If there was multiple things in a hex, like infantry and AFV or whatever, I would choose what I'm targeting. In this case, we only have infantry, and it doesn't look like we can place smoke or white phosphorus at this point, so we're just going to choose infantry. And there we go. So our attack here, we're firing, and it did not keep its rate of fire. So unfortunate, didn't do a lot of anything. That's all right. We don't expect too much out of it because it spent a lot of time moving, and I don't know, it doesn't have a lot of time to line up enemies. You can see we actually have all the different units here highlighted. We can actually choose this guy up here, or we can choose one of these guys. I really would like to get rid of that unit because it has that line of sight down that road. I don't like that. Of course, if you want to see the terrain and not have the counters, there is a button up here, I believe. Nope, that's a jump to map. This one. Doop, right there. So you can turn them on and off really quickly to kind of see. Oh, okay. Where do I want to go? What do I want to see? And it's easier to see, obviously, if you don't have enemy units in the way. All right. The other thing is we can still target with this guy with our bow machine gun. Unfortunately, didn't get a hit. And then lastly, select our guy, right click, and hit him with our coaxial. So we hit him with our coaxial machine gun. We broke the unit, number one. And the second unit in there, battle hardened. So they decided that they basically increased in quality by becoming battle hardened. So that's unfortunate. Fortunate we were able to break one of them though. Anytime you break a unit, they get a B plus symbol on them. And then once they try to rally from that B plus, they will just go to broken mode, and then from broken mode, obviously back to full quality unit. So having that broken unit there with that machine gun is going to help. All right, so that was just our one tank. The other thing I should show you guys here is this is our facing, which happens to be right down this hex spine here. And if you're not sure what your arc is, you can always come up here to the top and click on the button to display your covering arc. If you actually have a unit like this and you do that button, you'll notice it's just all yellow buttons, and that represents it only has one facing. When we click on our vehicle, you notice it's red and yellow. So the yellow will show you which way your vehicle's facing, and the red dots will show you which way your turret is facing. So if our turret was facing up to the north, you would see a bunch of red dots up to the north there. Do guns or armor fighting vehicles' main gun gain acquisition if firing the same head on subsequent turns? Jack, you are almost like a prop for me, buddy. Yes, they do, and we're going to see that here in the next turn. So I'm actually going to turn this off, and we're going to use this. And so we know this tank here, as Jack just asked a good question. What it does is it basically figures out that this unit is shooting at this unit and gives it an acquisition mark, which means it's easier for this unit to attack this spot the next time it does it, because it's already been kind of scoped in and they figure out if they're shooting too far or too short or to the left or whatever. So since this tank is already firing, this tank is already firing at this hex, we don't really want to put this tank on that hex. We want to give this tank a different target to shoot up. I'm thinking, and all I'm doing right now is just basically right-clicking on a hex right now. This looks like a pretty powerful group there. A couple first-line units with a light machine gun. What do you guys think? Should we go after the heavy machine gun up on the hill? Should we go after the two first-line units with the machine gun? Or should we go... Wow, we got two first-line units and a medium machine gun in there. So, your guys' choice. A heavy machine gun up here in the hill, medium machine gun hill, or the squads with the light machine gun. And there is about a 20-second delay, so I'll give you guys a second to type anything in. Of course, we're going to select our hex. We're going to select our vehicle. No for the hill. All right. No going for the hill. I think I actually, now that I realize that this is a medium machine gun here, I want to take this guy out as well. So you see I've targeted it and a little message comes up. I can always hit the escape key if I decide, oh, I don't want to do that. What do you guys think, the medium machine gun here? Let's look at this hex again. Boop. Yeah, that I think that is a medium machine gun. These are light machine guns. It's got to be a medium. Yeah, let's take out the medium machine gun. All right. So, again, selecting our AFV. We're going to use our main armament and infantry. Come on, give us a good result. And it didn't keep its rate of fire. Unfortunate. All right. Select it again. Right click. Unfortunate. And one more. Come on, baby. Give us something good. Nope. All right. We do have our student camp here. Let's highlight it. And, oh, you know, this is, I always do this. Guys, I know I was trying to show you this earlier. I always think range is the R button. Range is not R, okay? The F is the fire range. R is for route. So that's why it wasn't popping up earlier. And you can see now I've got this guy selected. He's got a range of about 1,000,000 miles, so we don't have to worry about range with this guy. Okay, so what do you think? Again, put some firepower there. Let's look at his covering arc, actually. All right, I'm going to put some firepower up here on the hill. I'm going to try it, all right? So we're going to use our coaxial. Unfortunate, did not keep a rate of fire again, and then we're going to use our... That does not keep a rate of fire either. All right, and then last but not least, we have our... what is this guy here? It is our other vehicle. Student Comp 251/9. I guess he'll target this hex. So we'll have this guy go after that hex, this guy go after this hex, this guy go after this hex, and this guy go after the hill. So a little 4-on-4 action here. Although I would like to break these guys, because that allow us to maybe come across here with our units. A couple of these units need to come in here and take over this town. But I think we'll do this. So this one's a little bit different because this one over here had machine guns. This one has like a main armament. So, and infantry. And, wow, does not keep his rate of fire. So unfortunate for us, we were having a lot of vehicles that just did not do very good with their rate of fire. All right, so that is the advancing fire segment. You can pretty much count that your fire, if you do end up doing some damage, is lucky when you're in the advanced fire phase, because it's just really, really hard to, you know, just think of like football, for example. Quarterback goes back in the pocket, sits there, throws at his receiver, and half the time he misses anyways. Now you got a quarterback goes back in the pocket, he's getting chased out of the pocket, and he throws the ball. 9 times out of 10, it doesn't even come close to where it's supposed to go. So just, you know, it's very hard to move and then fire at the same time. All right, so we are done with our advanced fire segment. We're going to go ahead and go into our route segment. So whoever the attacker is for that part of the round always routes first. So in this case, we have to route our leader and our half squad here because they are both broken. You will see hexes that we can move into. And you also see over here a low crawl button. So if you wanted to low crawl, you could do that. So in this case, if we look at our actual remove the units off the board, we're here. If we, that's a brush hex. Okay. So if we can route into this hex, we shouldn't have line of sight back and forth, so he shouldn't be able to attack us, so that's obviously a good thing. So we will roll crawl into that hex, and that was, oh no, we've got some units over here that are broken. Oh yes, so three of them got broken. We're going to try and get them back into this building, but we're going to, oof. You can always recover morale easier if you're inside a building or a forest location. If I go there, does he have line of sight to me? That's a question, because I don't think he can. All right, good. There we go. There is a line of sight tool in here, by the way. If you always wanted to check your line of sight, you can click on this little button here, put in your source and destination hexes, and it'll tell you whether or not there are line of sight. Our squad's penalized firepower in the advanced fire phase, even if they haven't moved in the movement phase. Don't know that answer, Jack. I can try to find out for you and let you know if that is the case. I don't know, but I'll see if I can find that out for you. All right, so that's pretty much the route segment for our side. Now we'll go over to their side and see whether or not they route their units. And they decided not to actually route these units. You don't have to if you're inside a building. There's advantages and disadvantages both ways. The biggest disadvantage is if this hex gets fired upon again, your units will become B plus again. So moving them out of there, but what I think he's hoping is that the leader in that hex is going to rally him, and he's not going to have to worry about having a broken squad. So now we're in the advanced segment. So in the advanced segment, your squads only, not your vehicles, but your squads only can move up one adjacent space. So you can see we are highlighted, and We have three squads and a sergeant here. I'm more concerned about getting this. Let's do this guy first. We want to put our heavy machine gun right here. We're going to put our big stack of units there. We've got another pretty good stack of units. We could put them here. What is this? What's in here? Demo charge and some elites. Just trying to figure out who we should line up here and who we should try to move across. Let's try and move these guys across. So we'll move them there. Bring these guys up So we're losing a little bit of firepower here because we haven't... I think what we'll do is just put these guys there. We'll move our squad up. White mortar. There. These guys are in a building. Just if you forget, you can always, again, get rid of the units there. These guys are broke. These guys we definitely need to move up behind the building so they can't get shot at again. And these guys here are looking for a fight as well. We're going to put them right here because that'll give us line of sight back this way a little bit. Aha! More guys! What do we have there? Oh, some more light machine gunners. Light machine gunners and some first line squads. So I believe that is everyone that can advance and close combat. There is no close combat because we're not that close yet. And that is one half of one of our turns. It now switches and the Russian player becomes the attacker. We are the defender. So we're going to go through the same process, but they're going to get to do all their phases first, and some of the phases we don't actually get to do, like the movement phase, we don't get to move, but we will get to offensive fire. So being the defender does not mean you are helpless. So administrative segment here, we're going to find out. Our sergeant failed to rally himself, and it gives you the hex coordinate, and our sergeant failed to rally himself. So the guy here didn't rally, and the guy here didn't rally. So these guys are going to be kind of out of it for a little while. All right, so now we're going to the fire segment, and the computer is going to go nuts on us here. Oh my gosh, that is at least three attacks. I'm going to actually scroll back here a little bit so we can see what had happened. So it shot at us. It kept its rate of fire, and it shot at us again. It broke our sergeant and kept his rate of fire. And then it shot at us again and did not keep his rate of fire. So this thing hit us three times and ended up breaking our leader in that hex. Well, that's okay. I'm glad he didn't break our heavy machine gun guy because that would have been terrible. But we're not done. We're just waiting for... The stream started at 8 o'clock tonight, guys. We're going to be doing a live stream every night for the until Tigers on the Hunt full release, February 25th. So probably every night, probably between 8 and 9, 10 o'clock. Become a subscriber and you will get an email, or one of the options is to receive an email when we go live, and that way you'll know when we're doing it. Or, of course, check the Matrix forums. I've been posting there when we're doing our live streams. So if you go to the Tigers on the Hunt forums on Matrix Games website, you can watch there. So went through what we just experienced here. What is this thing up here? So what we'll do is we'll actually get rid of the markers so we can take a look at what this unit is. Yeah, pretty nasty. So now we're just sitting here. The computer's waiting. It's got an itchy trigger finger. It's waiting for us to do something, but I don't want to hit the AI continue button. Oh, here we go. Medium machine gun does not keep its rate of fire. That's actually good for us. Heavy machine gun did not keep its rate of fire. Ooh, good. He shot his... Oh, I forgot. We got to get rid of that AT rifle quick. Did not penetrate our vehicle. This guy's got to go. That's an AT rifle in there, isn't it? Yep. Okay. It looked like a light machine gun. Oh, we got an AT rifle up here as well. So he's got a light machine gun and he's also got an AT rifle. Yikes. Okay, so this, we got to get rid of these guys. Obviously, they knew they could hear our tanks coming, so they all ran up to the front line. Fortunately, it didn't penetrate our vehicle. Got some more attack coming from over here. Pinned our unit, which is not good, actually. And more attack. Well, they don't like that heavy machine gun. They want to get rid of it. They know what's coming. Fortunately, he's still alive. He's pinned, but he's still alive. They want to get rid of that heavy machine gun. Light machine gun fired, and a squad did not keep its rate of fire. Pinned and broke us. Boy, these guys, tell you. Another unit shooting. Look at that. Two light machine guns. Both of them did not keep their rate of fire. That is great. So that's two light machine guns in there. Yep. Okay. Whew. All right. So we lived through that. Now is this movement segment. Let's see if we see him move anywhere. We're going to kill him. Nope. He decides. Pretty smart. Computer's pretty smart. He knows he's in a good defensive position. Somebody who set up the scenario, which will remain nameless, set him up in a pretty good position. So they don't need to do much movement. All right, so now we are on the defensive fire segment. So this will be the first time we're the defenders, but basically just an overview. During the Russians' movement segment, if any of our units defensive fire on them, they get the first opportunity, which is what they call first fire, and it's at full firepower. And then if they choose to defensive fire again, it's called final fire, and you're basically at half firepower. There is an opportunity one more time, or last time, to fire defensively, which is your final protective fire, which is basically a last-ditch effort as somebody moves up adjacent to you. Any units that fired during their opponent's movement phase, though, cannot defensive fire in the defensive fire segment. So we didn't take any shots during the movement phase, so everybody will have our full capabilities to shoot, except for anybody that's become broken or anyone that has become pinned. So when you're pinned, it's rather bad because your firepower is not very good. And I believe that pinned units don't keep rate of fire. So that's obviously not good, because what we were hoping to do was get our heavy machine gun and just tear into these guys and break them so we can storm across the bridge. Looks like we have to take care of, what is this thing up there on the hill? Or that's not a hill, but just in the back there. All right, so we do have, let's go from the top up here. So we have a demo charge. Demo charges are only good adjacent units. So obviously we're not at that point yet, but we can use our squads. Let's remove the units from the map so we can see. So it looks like a wood building and a wood building. And the other unit is right there, which looks like it's in brush. So what is our range here? Firepower F is firepower range. He's outside our range, so we can't shoot at him with these units. Get rid of that. So these two units, obviously they're the ones highlighted. That's why it's easier just to leave the line of sight tool on, so I know that this guy's out of range. Looks like just a guard unit or a leader and a guard. Let's put that up there. And we did absolutely nothing to him. Good job, guys. Alright, now we got a leader and a couple Faschenjägers and a light machine gun. Now this guy is in range, so we need to take that guy out. Alright, so shot. And our light machine gun does not keep its rate of fire. So if it would have kept its rate of fire, we would be able to shoot it again, but not the other units. Yeah, final protective fire. Firing unit can suffer possibly of breaking. That is correct. Yes. So when you're final protective fire, you are basically doing a morale check on yourself. And you can end up breaking yourself. So, yep, pretty much. Let's see here. Can we target anything with this guy? Nope. nope, we got to get this guy out here, up here, quicklier. Okay, they're out of range. Oh, we are in the defensive fire segment, so now we should be able to do our radio. There we go. The reason we weren't able to do it in the beginning, I think, is because you actually have to have a target. Or we might have been because we were out of line of line of sight range. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's try that again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So these units can barely see one another. Remember, it is morning time, morning fog. So we're going to use our radio, and we're going to try for this hex right there. So when I click it, what's going to end up happening is the first thing it's going to do is find out which of our off-board artillery it's going to be using. In this case, we only have one, so it chose, obviously it chose that one. If we had two of them, we could choose which of those to do. The first thing it's going to do is try to make radio contact with it, which it was successful. So it made radio contact, which is always a good thing. The next thing is they have to basically be ready to accept the call and start shooting, but they were not ready, so the battery access was not successful. So we won't be able to get any defensive fire right now. We can try again. Now, it's important to note that if you don't have battery access twice in a scenario, then you lose it for the rest of the scenario. So have to make sure we get it next time. All right, so that was this guy back here. I think our line squads are out of range, but let's just double check there. Yep, out of range. So I think we can shoot at long range, which we'll take a pot shot at him because it is three squads. So what this does is it's going to show you the range of the units, but of course you can shoot at long range. This guy doesn't have anybody. These guys are all broken still. We do have, yes, I know that. We do have one squad here. I'm going to turn that back off. Shot over there, which doesn't do much. These guys don't have line of sight. These guys don't have line of sight. These guys, I'm trying to save our better units to the end here. These guys, remember these guys were B-plus over here? Notice now they're just down to regular broken. They're not broken plus anymore, which means it's easier for these guys to rally, which hopefully they will. These guys have not shot yet, have they? No? Okay, let's shoot them. Oh, they have shot. Yes? Yes, they have shot. Let's leave our markers on. That's why. Couldn't find our markers. Okay, so they shot. All right, so we've got our vehicles left. All right, so we've got to get our vehicles moving here, right? We've got to get some damage done by these guys. Now, notice when I click on our unit now, you will notice that what we talked about before from Jack's comment, you notice it's got an acquired hex, which is 1127, which happens to be this hex right here. And if you're not sure, anytime my mouse goes over a hex, it'll show up here in the corner and shows you the hex coordinates as well. So now it's going to be easier. Number one, we're not moving anymore. And number two, we've already got a target on this position. So let's hopefully we can get a couple good shots on this guy and break his butt. All right, first thing, shoot the main armament at the infantry. Oh, okay. So we did something here. Let's take a look at what we did. So the sergeant is pinned, and the elite unit's pinned, and we do not keep our rate of fire. So unfortunate for us, but we're not done yet. We can still shoot our machine guns at it, and we can still shoot our coaxial machine gun. Not a lot. Alright, this guy has acquired hex 1128, which I believe is this hex right there. So let's go ahead. Main armament, infantry. Once again, does not keep a rate of fire. My bowel machine gun, which does nothing. And our coaxial machine gun, which does nothing, unfortunately. Alright, this guy's acquired hex 1128, which I believe is this hex right here. So we're going to use that. Come on, give us a good result. Oh, there we go. Well, alright, so pin. So pin results, if they had moved and their defense, and they're going to be firing in the advanced fire phase, any pin units are, of course, half firepower. And it also prevents them from advancing like we did those one adjacent spaces as well. Oh, hey, look at that. We kept our rate of fire. All right, about time. Do some more damage. This time does not keep rate of fire. Unfortunate. Last but not least, we have our, this guy up here. And I think he is, he's still in motion, actually. We never stopped him, so unfortunately, I forgot to stop him. That's probably why he didn't do a lot of damage last time, and he's not going to do a lot of damage this time. It shows you right there in motion, so you always want to look at all the text about your units. So we'll take a shot. Oh, we pinned it, which is okay. And we kept our rate of fire, which is excellent. So we will shoot again. More coaxial damage. Come on. Nope. And kept its rate of fire again. Wonderful. I like this vehicle. Keep coming, baby. It does not keep its rate of fire now. But we do have our other armament here, the AA. And does not keep its rate of fire on that. Okay, well, we pinned him. We've pinned a lot of his units, which is good. Keep him from advancing around a bunch. And you notice that this unit here, the Russian player, left that unit there. And it went to broken mode. But as soon as it takes firepower again, it goes back to B+, which is broken plus. And it's harder to recover in broken plus. So you always want to make sure you move your broken units away so they can't be attacked by your enemies. So this shows it's not done, but it is done. Okay. This guy doesn't have line of sight to anybody. Nope. These guys are broken, and I think that is our defensive fire. All right. So he did advance up with somebody. And took a shot and did not do any damage. And that is done. Now we'll do the routes. And he did his. The computer does theirs really fast, obviously. And then we'll stop if there's an interdiction or we see them routing. A lot of times you don't actually see them. They go out of sight. So and so now it's our turn. You can see up here in the top right-hand corner, it shows the Germans. So we're going to route our sergeant. Okay. I'm going to put him there. I'll put him there. There we go. He's out of sight. Nobody can hit him. And then he can move up and help these guys, hopefully, eventually. These guys are still... Two of them are still broken. But they're in a good position, so I'm just going to leave them right where they're at. So, and these guys are okay. They're kind of back away from everything. So I think we're okay routed-wise. Now, of course, we have the advanced fire segment. I'm sorry, the advanced segment where enemies can advance up. Now, it doesn't matter if I have line of sight to them or anything. It doesn't matter. I cannot fire at them in the advanced segment. This just basically gives you a little bit of extra movement last minute to dive into covering or move into a hex with an enemy so that you can try to close combat them. So you can see he's doing a couple little advances here. Looks like he has another advance down here. Again, doesn't matter if we have line of sight to him. we cannot stop. And of course, it's just infantry that can advance, no vehicles. Does not matter whether a vehicle is in motion or not. That does not matter. They can still not move in the advance phase. So we started the second turn there. It popped up. And you can see we're on turn 2 of 9. We have a sergeant that failed to rally himself in 324. Was that still over here? Yep, you can see up here. These guys are still broken. We do have a unit that rallied himself in 923, which happens to be 923. Oh, so this guy's rallied here. We have another unit that rallied in there. So all these guys came back. And then we have a unit that failed in 1124. So our sergeant here did not rally. So these guys back here are still broken. This guy here, the sergeant that just fell back from the heavy machine gun, still broken. But these guys earlier that were attacked on the road are now back to full capabilities here. You can see we got them all back up and ready to go. Our leaders rallied up the troops together. And we can start pretty much another turn. But you know what, folks? Before we start another turn, I am going to go ahead and just end this live stream tonight. Before we break, though, I'm going to go ahead and save it. And we're going to call this Revenge for Bruno 1. Excuse me, apologize. Can you click on a hex to see which hex the unit is in? Oh, you mean down here? No, you can't do that. No. It's just kind of like an overlay window. So you can't click on anything down in here to see where it is. Hopefully, eventually, maybe we will. So that was basically turn number one of Tigers on the Hunt, or Revenge for Bruno scenario that I created in the scenario editor, and we basically completed one full turn. I'm going kind of slow to show everybody because I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with the old ASL rules, which this game of course is strongly inspired by. I'm just not sure, you know, if everyone understands what the different segments do and what you can do in each of the segments. So we're just going kind of slow to teach people as so they can see how things go and understand how the rules work in the system. So just before we end here, just a couple things to note, guys. Number one, check out the Matrix Games website, the Slytherin website, to find out all the information. This game full releases February 25th. Check out the Matrix Games forums. We're going to be posting. Information on what we're going to be doing. We're going to be live streaming every night from now until full release, and then we have a special event on Monday, February 22nd, from 2:00. We're going to continue our scenario that we were making the other night here on our live stream as well. So there will be no charts and tables whatsoever in the game manual or to be released by the developer of the game. That doesn't mean that other people won't do that, but the developer has kind of decided he wants people to focus on battlefield tactics and strategies as opposed to worrying about actual trying to figure out all the numbers of the system. And to tell you the truth, I totally agree with them. I played many, many face-to-face ASL games, and you spend more time trying to calculate, okay, well, if I got 6 movement points, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, no, let me try that again. 1, 2, 3. It just takes forever, and it just drags on the game. Without that information, I basically playing the game and not worrying about trying to calculate everything up, and it makes the game so much faster. Now, again, that's just developers are not going to be releasing that information. Does that mean that somebody else won't calculate it up and release that information? I don't know. Anyways, February 22nd, 2:00 Eastern Standard Time, doing our live stream here on this channel, and every night, check out the forums on the Matrix Games website. We're going to be broadcasting live tomorrow night. We're going to continue with turn two from our Revenge for Bruno scenario that we were working on tonight. Hopefully everybody enjoyed it. Tomorrow night, I think we'll try to go a little bit faster unless people have questions about what's going on. You can create fire groups, but you cannot create them in multi-hexes fire groups. So you can create fire groups in one hex, as many units as are in that hex, with all their support weapons. You cannot create fire groups from multiple different hex locations, though. All right, so that is turn one of Revenge for Bruno. Guys, thanks so much for joining us. Again, go to the Matrix Games forums. Give the developer a big thumbs up. Let them know that you checked out the video. You like what you see. If you have any questions about it, be sure to post there. He's on there all the time and replying back to people's messages. And again, it's just from what I understand, one gentleman that is taking it upon himself to create this game for us. And if you haven't checked out our video on how to do map editing and creating and scenario editing and creating, the part one is up on the Matrix Games YouTube channel, and part two is coming February 22nd here live at 2 o'clock p.m. Check out all their other videos. I know the developer's got videos in the works and has already released some tutorial videos on helping you guys understand how the system works. So thanks one and all for joining us tonight. Do appreciate it very much. And again, if you have any other further questions, check out the forums on Matrix Games. And we will see you guys tomorrow night for our second turn here of Revenge for Bruno, and see if we can finally do some damage to the Russians. So thanks for joining us tonight. We'll see you guys tomorrow night.